DJ Envy, Angela Yee, and Charlamagne the God.
Wake that ass up. The Breakfast Club is on
right now.
I am feeling blessed. I'm talking to the Breakfast Club this morning.
Okay.
I love coming here. I'm never not going to come here. You guys are good to me. In return, I'm always going to be good to you.
For a lot of people in the hip-hop generation, the Breakfast Club is where people get the information on the topics, on the artists, and everything like that. In that aspect, radio is still important.
The Breakfast Club.
When my name come up, respect it.
Good morning, USA.
Yo.
Good morning, Angela Yee.
Good morning, DJ Envy.
Charlamagne the God.
Peace to the planet. Guess what day it is? Guess what day it is?
Pump day.
Good morning.
Good morning
to you. How are you?
I'm doing great. How are you guys doing?
I am blessed, black, and highly favored. What's happening, man? Happy to be alive. Happy to be here. Life is good.
Life is good. Can't complain. Now, shout to LaDoon. We know LaDoon. He does the clothing line, My God Versus My Enemies.
Okay.
He's also an actor.
He's an actor. He's been in Power. He's been in a couple of sitcoms and movies. And yesterday was his birthday, so he had a little shindig out in Jersey. So I swung by there.
Oh, a shindig.
A little shindig.
Okay.
It wasn't a party.
Happy born day,
LaDoon. Like a little shindig, a little get together. Everybody just, you know, celebrating his life and showing him a lot of love. So happy birthday, LaDoon.
LaDoon's a good guy.
Yes, he is. LaDoon,
he always pulls up to my TV show, The God's Honest Truth. He always comes to the tapings.
Mm-hmm.
Quite often.
Well, yesterday I went to go see Ida Rodriguez. She was at Dumbo House doing a talk because her special's out on HBO Max.
Mm-hmm.
So that was nice. I have this, Dumbo House is part of this thing called Soho House for people who don't know about it. It's like some, you have to pay an annual fee to be able to go to the different Soho houses, and they have these different events there. So she was talking there to promote her special.
Yeah, they just don't let anybody there. They decline a bunch of celebrities. It's for people that are well off or know people.
That's not really what it's for.
Oh.
It's actually, they don't like you to, first of all, when you go there, they tell you they don't like people to wear suits there. They want you to come like super casual. They don't want it to be like a stockbroker's thing. And they give discounts to people under a certain age, too, so that they want to make it more like a fun, artistic, creative type of environment.
Y'all so rich. I'm just happy to have a Costco card. Okay? That's all.
Yeah, I ain't paying for that.
And for people who don't know who Ida Rodriguez is, she'll be here this morning.
Yes, comedian. She'll be joining us. She has a special out right now, so we'll kick it with her.
If you saw Tiffany Haddish's Day Ready special, Ida was on the Day Ready special as well.
Mm-hmm. You know what I'm going to do this weekend? I'm going to try to see if I can get a Sam's Club card.
You don't have a Sam's
Club
card?
Why would you have to see if you can get one? You can go online right now and do it.
No, when I was in college, I allegedly stole out of there. And
stole out of
there. They banned me. So I
wanted to
steal out of Sam's.
Huh?
How you steal out of Sam's?
What did you steal?
Everything comes in bulk in Sam's.
The DVD players back in the day.
Would you put it under your jacket?
No. Just quickly. So what we would do, we'd go on Sundays and we'd dress up and act like we're coming from church. Me and my friend Little Sean. Y'all know Little Sean. And we would go there with the shopping cart and we'd load it up with DVD players and then we'd just roll right out.
Yeah, I don't know if I would even trust that in Sam's. I feel like you'll just get tackled in Sam's. And Sam's got them metal detectors that don't play at all.
That was before that.
So clearly you didn't get away with it.
No.
Exactly. Ain't no stealing out of Sam's.
It's really slick. Let me just take this DVD player and walk out.
Ain't no stealing out of Sam's. Ain't no stealing out of Costco. I don't think if somebody has ever accomplished those goals, good for you. I don't think it's possible.
Somebody told me that's why I got
caught. Know, in certain stores, they're not allowed to stop you if you steal. I found this out. So people will just walk in, take stuff, and the people that work there just can't do anything.
Oh, no. This was back in the day in Virginia. They would have tackled me.
Now they can't. They're not allowed to stop
you. They would have tackled me in college.
Tackled in Costco or Sam's. Yeah. I really feel that way. They're not playing about Costco or Sam's.
I'm good at Costco. I just ain't try Sam's Club.
Have your wife do it.
Have your wife steal?
No, get a card.
Get a card, you idiot. What's wrong with you, man?
Like what?
All right, let's get the show cracking. Front page news, what are we talking about?
Well, since you're talking about stealing, let's talk about what's going to be even more expensive. As you can see, prices are going up, and we'll talk about certain options that were used to being cheap that are now about to get even more expensive.
All right, we'll get into that next. It's The Breakfast Club. Good morning. Morning, everybody. It's DJ Envy, Angela Yee, Charlamagne Tha God. We are The Breakfast Club. Let's get in some front page news. Where we starting, Ye?
Well, let's start with things that are about to be more expensive in the grocery stores. And they said even hot dogs, burgers, and deli meats are about to get more expensive. Now, a lot of things have gone up. Higher-end meat cuts like steak, veal, pork chops. Those prices have surged over the past year. But things like ground beef and lunch meat haven't gone up too much. Hot dogs actually cost less than they were at the same time last year. But now they're saying all those prices are about to go up.
Well, so, inflation is real. Mm-hmm. Inflation is real. I'm no financial expert, but I was always told inflation is the sign of a healthy economy. And this usually happens after, like, you know, there's a downturn. Yeah, like after a global pandemic, because this is like economic recovery is what they call
but
it.
But the problem is, are people making more money to pay for that stuff? Like, you look at gas prices shooting up and all these, but are people making more money? I don't think so.
I don't know if they're making more money, but I know people are more willing to spend when they have more money. So I guess because of... Oh, that's probably all gone now, but all those PPPs and...
I think that's done.
unemployment. Mm-hmm. People had a lot of bread. And corporations raise prices when people are buying more.
It's just hard to also have to pass those prices to the customers. Like, I know in the juice bar, the price of everything has gone up. It's impossible to even get shipments of cups. We used to get boxes of cups in, and now they only let you order one at a time, one box. So we're always low on cups, and then the cost has gone up tremendously. And then it's hard because then you have to tell customers, well, now we got to raise the price on this because it's costing us so much more. So,
and I'm noticing things are locked up now more in CVS and Walgreens. Like, I don't ever remember deodorant being locked up like it is now.
And like, I see a lot of shelves empty. Like certain things that you used to try to buy and then go in the store and you're like, where's all the products?
Mm-hmm.
All right, now Congress has a new requirement for automakers. They want you to find a high-tech way to stop people from drunk driving. So it's one of the mandates that they have aimed at improving auto safety because there's been a lot of fatalities on the road.
Mm-hmm.
It's part of that $1 trillion infrastructure package that Joe Biden is expected to sign soon. So they said monitoring systems to stop intoxicated drivers would roll out in all new vehicles. This is going to happen as early as 2026.
Yeah,
I'm not mad at that.
Great.
I don't know how that's going to work. Remember when they had that seatbelt thing at one time where the seatbelt automatically came down on you? You know what I'm talking about?
No.
It was a thing with a seatbelt.
I'll tell you what does work, though, when it starts beeping nonstop, and you, like, put your seatbelt on, because that works.
I know in some cars, they have the thing where you have to actually blow into the device before you can start the car.
Right.
You know what I think is stupid? You know, the brother who, you know, killed the young lady that played for the Raiders, what was his name?
Henry Ruggs.
Yeah.
His car was going 156 miles per hour, right?
Mm-hmm.
Why should a car go 156 miles per hour? Why should a regular car that you drive in the street go 156 miles per hour? Why? The speed limits most places are 70, 80 miles per hour. Why would you have a car that could go 100, that goes that fast? Why would you have a car that goes over the speed limit?
Well, a lot of people track those cars, those sports cars. A lot of people track them.
So I don't know what you mean when you say track.
Well, they put them on the track and they go around the track like race car drivers. You're allowed to buy cars to go on the track. Like, a lot of people buy those high performance cars to go on the track. But
it feels to me like automatic weapons, right? Like, I'm not like when you the big joints, like the AK-47s mm-hmm. and the choppers. It's like, why make those for sale for regular everyday people?
Right. Well, currently, convicted drunk drivers have to use breathalyzer devices that are attached to an ignition interlock. They blow into the tube. It disables the vehicle if their level is too high. But the legislation doesn't specify what technology. It just has to pass the performance of a driver of a motor vehicle to accurately identify whether that driver may be impaired. Mm. I think that's a positive thing.
I think so.
All right. Well, that is your front page news.
A little annoying, but it's definitely safe for everybody.
You know? 100%. Since the day Ubers don't work for whatever reason, and they Lyfts and whatever else, like rides, so many ride shares out here now, it's like kind of crazy to get caught drunk driving.
One poor decision can affect your life, people's lives that you don't even know, people around you, people in the car with you. So
yeah, I just would see it having a problem. Like, you blowing it, it wouldn't start. You would not drunk. Like, I just see it having a problem. But I think it would definitely help with a lot of people.
Because you're used to when you blow it, it starts, right?
Get it off your chest. 800-585-1051. If you need to vent, hit us up right now. Maybe you had a bad morning, a bad night. Maybe your coworker's being annoying so early in the morning. Whatever
what
it may be.
What are you talking about?
Power 105.1.
Wake up, wake up.
Wake your ass.
This is your time to get it off your chest. Whether you're mad or blessed, we want to hear from you on The Breakfast Club.
Hello, who's this?
Hi, good morning. This is Cassandra from New Jersey.
Hey, Cassandra.
Hi, I want to talk about the missing girl from East Orange.
Yeah, I heard it this morning.
My God,
I heard that she went to the store and they believe she was possibly kidnapped.
Yeah, she went to the store, but what I'm not understanding is why did it take Eastar's police and my good friend, and Ted, Mayor Ted Green is my good friend, why did it take them almost 2 weeks to really put out information about the young lady being missing? And then from my understanding, talking with activist Donna Jackson, there was no, police put out something called a FOB or something like that to notify other police departments that somebody is missing. None of that took place, so FBI was informed. We was out looking for her last night in another city, another town rather, and when the police officer arrived, he had no idea what we were talking about because he didn't get the information about her either. And that was going on almost a month.
Wow.
Yeah. Missing.
She's been missing since October 14th. That's crazy.
How old is she?
14.
She's 14.
Wow.
And so why didn't we not put that information out for so long?
You're right.
And so Amber Alert only for that they missed in a car?
I think Amber Alert is only for car because I think they look for car, but I'm not 100% sure. But you're
they
right,
the
that
license
information should have been
number.
Out. Yeah, that information should have been out a long time ago. I just heard it this morning for the first time.
I'm just hearing about it right now.
That's right, Libby. That's how did you just hear? And you know, you guys know everything. How did you just hear about her?
So, you're right.
And I live in Jersey. That's
I saw it on
thing.
The news this morning because of the reward money that they have for
right, because of the reward money. Mm-hmm. Absolutely. So today, our Essex County Prosecutor's Office is probably going to do a press conference and probably announce more money. So, you know, now people are getting involved because the money are involved. But how did you guys and other people just now knowing about this 14-year-old girl? Business?
You're right.
I'm just hearing about it because of you. What's her name?
Deshaya.
Her name is so hard to pronounce. So I'm going to say J4 because it's very hard to pronounce.
I think it's like Deshaya Moore.
Yeah.
Deshaya.
Very sad.
Is there any way that you guys can, Charlamagne, also back here this April 5th of this year, my good friend, Sharice Emmons-Peck, his daughter was ruled out her house. She's only been in your town, your state, South Carolina, 3 years. Ruled out her house by her girlfriend and her girlfriend's boyfriend. And they shot her 11 times and killed her. So
I heard about that.
The police department down there did the same thing. They waited for like weeks before they even gave him help. But because Sharice, you know, was adamant about finding his daughter, he went down there, and he's a Black Panther, he went down there with the Panthers, and they looked for his daughter. He found his daughter.
Wow.
So our girls are going missing, and can we just talk about it a little bit more if you guys don't mind?
Absolutely.
Well, you're talking about it now because, you know, sometimes we can't hear everything. And like I said, I'm from Jersey, and I just heard it this morning.
I'm about to post her on my Instagram and everything.
We appreciate you for calling and filling us in.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you guys so much.
All righty now.
Okay.
Hello, who's this?
Hey, what's up, man? This is Nick.
Nick, what up? Get it off your chest.
Hey, man, yeah, so homeboy said, why would you want a car that goes 150-some miles per hour to the boy off the Raiders, you know, speeding or whatever?
Yes.
So some kids are cheap anyway, so, you know what I mean? Basically, I was saying, like, you know, it's America, right? So why would you want a car to go that fast? Well, why would you want to be limited to that? Same thing with machine guns, you know? We're supposed to right to their arms, right?
What's the point if the speed limit is only 80 miles per hour? Like, you got to give me a reason why you driving on a highway and you have to go 100-plus miles per hour, especially when the speed limit is only 80. Like, tell me why. What's the point?
I don't know. There ain't really too many real valid reasons why you'd have to go that fast. All I'm saying is, why would they limit you to want to go? Like, then why would you want to limit
you? Because you can kill yourself and you can kill other people. Even if you're not drunk, just going that fast, you could kill somebody.
Yeah, I mean, I kind of agree. And I got a lot of high-performance cars that go fast and could hit probably over 200 miles an hour. I've never wanted to go that fast. I never even wanted to go close to that fast. But I agree. I mean, I don't think cars should go 160 miles per hour when the speed limit is only 80. Maybe in Europe where it is the Autobahn where you can go any however fast you want. But I also believe that in machine guns. I don't think civilians should have machine guns. I don't care if you're going hunting. You don't need to shoot a deer 36 times. You
know, why ruin that meat?
Yeah, that's just my personal. And I believe in the right to bear arms. But having a machine gun for a civilian, I just don't think that makes sense. Yeah.
So you called up here to debate something that you don't even really have a clear argument on.
No.
I was actually, I looked it up because they were saying in some countries, like the German Autobahn, you can go over that. You can go over 100 miles per hour. And they also said in order for cars to be able to accelerate, you know how they'd be like, oh, it goes from 0 to 60 in this many seconds. It also has to have the ability to go that fast for the acceleration.
I don't see the point in America.
I don't know about 160, though. Because 0 to 60, yeah, I mean, certain cars, I got cars
from
0 to 60 and 2.2, but I just don't know. I mean,
we don't have an Autobahn.
I own all those cars, but it's just I've never thought about, you know what, I'm going to go 160 today. I mean, some people do.
By the way, we don't have an Autobahn, and if you're going over 100 miles per hour and you wreck, you're guaranteed to die.
But and also,
so what's the
like,
point?
You know, only difference here is they make cars that are different for Europe, that are different for America, that is different for Toronto, that's different for Japan, because sometimes you can't even bring those cars over here unless you fix them to, you know, to meet America's standards. So
They said it'll limit the amount of power it has if you lower how fast it's able to go. Mm. The efficiency of the engine.
All right. Well, get it off your chest. 800-585-1051. We could also put limit on their cars. I got a limit on my son's car. My son has the same exact Corvette that the young man drove, and my son can't go nearly that fast.
How old is Logan? How old?
17, about to be 18.
So 17, just because he can do 150, he may say, F it one day.
He can't. I got a limiter on it.
And that's good, though. But I'm saying, imagine all the people who don't, and they just want to hit the gas.
With his friends, and somebody gas him.
Yeah, man.
It's scary.
Yeah. What's the point?
Get it off your chest. 800-585-1051. It's The Breakfast Club. Good morning.
The Breakfast Club.
This is your time to get it off your chest, whether you're mad or blessed.
So you better have the same energy.
We want to hear from you on The Breakfast Club.
Hello, who's this?
Dirty Jersey, how are you?
How are you?
Get it off your chest.
Why are you breathing so damn hard? What stairs you just walked up?
I'm not doing good at all. I've been calling y'all, like, ever, and I'm just like, I need to get this out.
Okay.
I filed a complaint against my employer. I was a probation officer in New Jersey. Mm-hmm. They came after my nephew.
What?
And they illegally incarcerated him because I filed a complaint because they don't like black people.
Whoa.
My nephew has mental health issues, and based on an evaluation, he qualified for not guilty by reason of insanity. At the time of the offense and when he signed his plea, he was not on his medication. So they still sentenced him to prison because I filed a federal lawsuit against him. If you Google my name right now, you'll see my federal lawsuit.
What's your name?
LYRESHIA. Last name, DONDS. I filed several complaints about how they treat black employees. Black employees are treated like slaves. I filed it with no attorney. They said I was incompetent and suspended me for not answering the email that was sent when I was out of work on FMLA.
Damn.
They came after my nephew. My nephew was 18 at the time of the crime, in and out of hospitals.
Wow.
He diagnosed with schizophrenia and everything. And it hurt. I'm about to cry. I'm trying not to
cry.
I'm
sorry.
Because you dealing with me, okay, I'm an adult. I can deal with y'all racism. But you coming after my innocent nephew, now he in solitary confinement.
Damn.
Lord have mercy.
Because they trying to kill him in prison. You got the correction officer saying he in there for rape.
What?
Yes. I've been trying to get help with him for the longest.
Well, how can people reach you in case there's any attorneys who are listening? What city are you in?
Jersey, she said.
I'm in New Jersey, in Middlesex County. If you go to Bond Consulting, my IG page is his GoFundMe. I need help.
Okay, I see you now. Okay, we
got
it.
Thank you, Mama. Hello, who's this?
This is Mike.
Mike, what's up, brother?
Not much, brother. What's good, man?
Blessed, black, and highly favored. What's happening?
Now, Marsh, I know you're not supposed to pat yourself on the back too much in this life. You got to be humble, but I just want to say something about myself during about the holidays. I was thinking, like, I just thank God because I came from, like, a single mother. I came, two other brothers, man, and I raised up doing stupid stuff and everything. And now I look at it, I got a CDL, man. I got beautiful kids. I got a beautiful wife. And I'm doing really good for myself. I was a worst kid growing up, and everybody thought I wouldn't be nothing. But I came down to be, like, wise, real good dude, and I got a good job, and I got a good crib, and I'm taking care of my family, and I thank God for that.
There you go.
That's all. That's your brother. And that you should definitely tell yourself that every day. That's not patting yourself on the back. And so, and if you are, so what?
I know.
Thank God, know, bro. See, thank God for it all.
I know, man, and I can't believe it. And my family, like, oh, they kind of mad that I turned out that way. I just thought I was that way growing up because I had my own path, but I'm on the search to learn it, and I am doing great, y'all. I'm telling you.
I'm proud of you, King. I'm proud of you.
Crazy, but I'm doing so good, and I swear to God.
I'm proud of you, King.
Absolutely.
I am proud of you.
Congrats on everything. That's
keep
dope.
Doing you,
keep
brother.
Going and growing. Don't stop.
Get it off your chest. 800-585-1051. Now, we got rumors on the way, Yee?
Yes, and we are going to talk about the sexiest man alive for 2021. Last year, it was Michael B. Jordan, according to People Magazine. So we'll tell you who is number one on that list this year.
I'll give you a hint. He's in this room.
On this sheet of paper.
All right. We'll get to it next. It's The Breakfast Club. Good morning.
The Breakfast Club.
Everybody, it's DJ Envy, Angela Yee, Charlamagne Tha God. We are The Breakfast Club. Let's get to the rumors. Let's talk Nas.
It's about time.
What's going on?
Rumor report. Rumor report.
This is The Rumor Report.
Talk to him.
With Angela Yee on The Breakfast Club.
Well, this is a beautiful thing. Nas has a podcast, and he's also going to be hosting with Miss Info. So it is to celebrate 50 years of hip-hop as hip-hop approaches its 50th anniversary. It'll be exclusively on Spotify later this month. And so The Bridge positions itself as a hip-hop history lesson in podcast form. Here is the trailer.
It's all about The Bridge, 50 years of hip-hop podcast. This is our opportunity to go deep and explore how hip-hop went from the microphones, turntables, and sound systems to big business and a worldwide cultural phenomenon.
Yep, every week, me and Nas talk to our personal heroes and the creative forces that shaped hip-hop and helped it grow.
You ever wonder what hip-hop legends talk about behind closed doors?
I think that's going to be dope.
It is. They're going to be guests like Ice Cube, Mary J. Blige, DJ Jazzy Jeff, Cordae, Nas's brother Jungle. So that's going to debut November 16th, and there'll be new episodes premiering weekly.
Shout out to Nas. Shout out to Miss Info. That's going to be dope.
Dope. And they're doing a doc on Showtime, too, right?
Yeah, it's a series on Showtime, too. So the way that's working, it's a series of documentaries and also a collection of new EPs from top-tier hip-hop producers like Premier, Swiss Beats, and Hit-Boy.
It celebrates hip-hop's 50th anniversary.
Mm-hmm. Of hip-hop.
Showtime don't miss with documentaries, by the way, at all. I was watching Attica last night on Showtime.
Listen, I told you that Teddy Pendergrass one.
Teddy Pendergrass, amazing. The Dick Gregory one, Amy Winehouse, Wu-Tang. Like, Showtime absolutely makes the best documentaries. Dropping the clues bombs for Showtime.
And since we're talking movies, let's talk about On the Come Up. That's written by Angie Thomas. Angie Thomas is the same person who wrote The Hate U Give. And you saw that. Remember, yes. You kept saying, I saw Thug. Well, this is another book she has. You kept calling it Thug, The Hate U Give. So On the Come Up. So they have announced that there'll be a pretty exciting cast. Sanaa Lathan is directing and co-starring in it. So that's really dope. Method Man Mike Epps is in it as well. I see they also have Lil Yachty set to be in it some way, somehow. So we don't know who's going to be playing who, but I think that's exciting. And I actually did this book On the Come Up. It's a young adult novel, and I did this for my book club with some of these young girls. And when I tell you the response was amazing to sit there and talk to them and have them relate their real lives to this book. It's such an amazing book, so I can't wait to see On the Come Up.
Yeah, my daughter loves Angie Thomas books. She read The Hate U Give, and she saw the movie. And it was another movie. It's another book she has.
On the Come Up.
That's the other one?
I just said, yeah.
Okay. I thought it was another one other than that, though.
No, she's a young girl who's a rapper. And, so.
No, I'm saying I thought Angie Thomas had other books.
Oh,
I
know.
It was another one.
Those are two books. This movie they already had said they were going to adapt it into a movie maybe 3 years ago they were talking about it.
Mm.
So it's happening. All right. Now, talking about people writing and R. Kelly's cellmate in Brooklyn, a man who was convicted of threatening to kill government officials, has a comic book now. The comic book is depicting his life with R. Kelly in jail, the two of them together. Brandon Hunt has submitted the drawings to the Brooklyn Federal Court as part of his former request to have his sentence be time served. And so the comic features him and R. Kelly meeting in a jail cell and follows their day-to-day activities, doing yoga, listening to music, working out, and getting buff together. And then they become, quote, unlikely friends. So he's hoping to get this comic book put out. All right, and congratulations to Nicki Minaj. Super Bass has become RIAA certified diamond. This one was released.
Congrats to her.
Before the streaming era, she wrote, and she said she is very grateful for her fans. Thank you for over a decade of support. Barb, special thanks to Esther Dean, Kane, Juice, Taylor Swift, Sophia Grace, and Rosie, Ellen, Young Money, Cash Money, and Republic.
Okay, dropping the clues bombs for Nicki Minaj. Mm-hmm. Big accomplishment.
Mm-hmm. It is.
Diamond.
Yep. It's a hell of a plaque.
All right. Well, that is your rumor report.
All right. We got front page news next. What are we talking about?
Yes. And we are going to be giving you some updates on what's happening with Ahmaud Arbery's trial.
Oh, Concrete Rose. That's the name of it. It was the prequel to The Hate U Give. It came out in January.
All right.
Yeah.
All right. Front page news is next. It's The Breakfast Club. Good morning.
The Breakfast Club. Your mornings will never be the same.
Warner Brother Pictures presents King Richard, based on a true story that will inspire the world. Watch Will Smith's portrayal of Richard Williams, father of two of the greatest sports legends, Venus Serena and A Plan for Greatness, in theaters and on HBO Max. King Richard, November 19th, rated PG-13. Morning, everybody. It's DJ MV Angela Yee, Charlamagne Tha God. We are The Breakfast Club. Good morning. Let's get in some front page news. Where are we starting, Yee?
Well, let's start with the trial for the three men who are being accused of killing. Well, they did kill Ahmaud Arbery. Now, they said that the man who initiated the chase that ended in Ahmaud Arbery's death changed his story about why he suspected that Ahmaud Arbery was running in his neighborhood and was a criminal, according to two police officers who testified yesterday. Glynn County Police Officer Jeff Brandenberry told the jury that Greg McMichael, one of the three white men on trial for murder in the case, at first told him that Arbery had been recorded by security cameras breaking in all these houses out here. He later on shifted his story and said that he only went into and targeted a single home, one that was still under construction with no doors or windows. They testified that McMichael told them they had seen two or three videos that showed this guy breaking into or being or wandering around into this house. So Greg McMichael, his adult son Travis McMichael, and the neighbor William Roddy Bryan are charged with murder and other crimes in the death of Arbery. Prosecutors are saying the men had no legal reason to pursue Arbery with guns, as there's no evidence that he committed any crimes. They do have video where he can be seen wandering through the open-framed interior of the house. He doesn't touch anything, and he ran after a neighbor outside, called police. Now, this was a house that's under construction. There's no doors, no windows, and there were a lot of people who would go in and wander around the house that was under construction, so it wasn't just him. So. Yeah,
I just wonder, when you're a lawyer, how do you feel defending something like this? You saw that video. You know damn well you see the same thing the prosecutors see, that they had no reason to bother that man. He had no weapons. They killed that man in cold blood for no damn reason. How do you feel defending that?
I'm sure they're racist.
And if they really, really believe that something, he did something or he stole, call the police. Who are you?
Because you can't defend
like,
that.
Who are you? You think you're going to chase somebody with a shotgun and kill him? And like, they really chased him, cornered him. And I know that has to be really hard for his family to imagine what his last moments were like.
I mean, the sad part is they can see what his last moments are like. That's even more traumatizing.
All right, now let's discuss one of our listeners called in this morning to talk about Josiah Moore, the 14-year-old who has been missing since October 14th. The family is holding held a search party yesterday on the corner of Amherst Street and Central Avenue in East Orange. And there was also going to be a prayer vigil. That's going to be happening on Friday. So they have since increased the reward of $15,000 after an anonymous local business owner's donation. And they are trying to find her. She went to the store. She was last seen around 10 a.m. at Poppy's Deli store in East Orange. Her mother asked her to go and get some groceries. Mm-hmm. The footage shows her entering the store with an older male who paid for her items. And it does not appear to show them leaving the store together, according to police. She got home to her mom. She had lost the card the family used for groceries, and so she told her daughter to retrace her steps to find it, and that was the last time that she saw her.
Hold on, so the video camera shows her going in but not coming out?
No, it doesn't show them leaving together with the guy that paid for the groceries. It's an older guy who paid for her items. The footage does not show them leaving the store together.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, she went back home and realized she had lost the card, went to go retrace her steps, and that was the last time her mom has seen her.
So when they retraced the steps, did she go back to the store? Did they see that, or we don't know?
No, they don't know where she went. That was just the last time she's been seen, when she went out of the house to go retrace her steps.
It bothers me that I live in New Jersey, and I'm just hearing about this story this morning.
Yeah, first time I heard about it was this morning.
Like, that is something I'd have been involved myself in, and whatever I can do to, you know, help amplify that story, holla at us. Holla at us, man. I mean,
Josiah is 5'5". She weighs about 135 pounds. Mm. And she was last seen wearing khaki pants, a black jacket, and black boots. If you have any information, please call the East Orange Police at 973-266-5041.
Lord have mercy.
All
sending
right.
Healing energy to that family. Prayers up definitely for that family. Mm. I hope they find, you know, I hope they find that young lady alive, safe and sound.
Absolutely.
That's what I'm hoping for.
And that is your front page news.
All right. Now, when we come back, Aida Rodriguez will be joining us.
Mm-hmm.
Comedian. She has a special out right now, so we're going to talk to her when
Fighting
we come
words.
Back. All right. So don't move. It's The Breakfast Club. Good morning.
The Breakfast Club. The Breakfast Club. Your mornings will never be the same.
Morning, everybody. It's DJ Envy, Angela Yee, Charlamagne Tha God. We are The Breakfast Club. Good morning. We got a special guest in the building.
That's right.
Aida Rodriguez.
What's up?
How are you?
Aida.
I'm good. I'm happy to be here. What's up? How y'all doing?
Bless, black, and highly favored.
So your special is out now. Congratulations.
Thank
Fighting
you.
Words is on HBO Max.
Thanks.
And it's not just a special. There's also documentary components to it.
Yeah, it's a little trauma porn for the white people who want to feel sorry for me. They gonna watch. Let's do it.
Yeah. But you went to Puerto Rico and you went to the Dominican Republic while you were filming this special.
Yeah.
And so can you talk about what that experience was like for you?
You know, I went to see my father. I hadn't seen my father since I was a baby. And I wanted to document it. I wanted to see what it after it happened because it was in the moment and I wanted to see it from outside. But I wanted to normalize that. I wanted people who haven't met their fathers, who meet them later in life, to feel like release the shame and the guilt, because I used to be ashamed of that. They used to always say, you illegitimate. You don't know your daddy, you know, all that stuff when I was a kid, because ghetto kids are cruel. Right. And I was like, I just want to normalize it. I want people, this is not just a black and brown thing. There are a lot of white people who don't know their mm-hmm. fathers, whose fathers abandoned them. A lot of people of different cultures. And for some reason, you always think about it like he's Dominican. And they're like, yeah, you know, you're Dominican. Daddy got a lot of kids from a lot of different people. They were right.
Right.
But
it's not a stereotype if it's true, right?
You said people kept coming in and he'd be like, that's your sister.
Yes, facts. And they all look different. Like, you know.
How many siblings do you have?
That I know of with him, six. But those are the documented ones. And not, you know, maybe he's telling the truth. I mean, but.
Is that something you always long for?
Yeah, I needed to. It's so funny because it just answered a lot of questions for me why I have these issues in relationships with men. It came from, all of it came from that very moment. And not that everybody has daddy issues, because mm-hmm. they like to say that about women, but I do. My issues come specifically from not knowing this man and trying to find him in relationships with the people that I've been involved with.
What was the first thing you wanted to ask?
Where you been? Like, I said, you know, the first thing I asked him was like, are you gonna give me a hug? Because he got really awkward with me. The moment,
because he don't know you, even though you his daughter.
Yeah,
he doesn't know what you want either.
Well, he also knows that my mom is like fire, so he was expecting me to be angry and hateful. And you know, I forgave him a long time ago, long before I ever met him. But he also looked really skinny. Mm-hmm. You know, he looked a little emaciated, and I was more concerned about him when I met him. And everybody that knows me was so upset with me, because they were like, even in that moment, you forgot about yourself and thought about the man who didn't take care of you.
Right.
So when you asked him, where have you been, what was his reply?
He put it all on my mom. Actually, he told me all his baby mamas were whack. He was like,
there's a common denominator here, sir.
He said they all cheated on him. And I was like, I was like, with all respect, you can't talk about my mother, because my mother was there. Also, my mother was 15 and you were 27.
Yikes.
So let's not talk about that, because I was like, what's the statute of limitations? You know,
right.
And it was a very, very interesting exchange.
It is, because, like, you know, over the years, you do learn to give your parents grace for certain mm-hmm. things, just because you realize they were doing the best that they could. But it's like, not being there for your child, you know, that's just something I can't come to terms with.
Me either. You know, and when it comes to people of color, black people in this country and around the world, and you have these issues that are very common, people get tired of hearing but slavery and white supremacy, but it all comes from that, right? That's in the DNA of the people, is in the psychology of the people. And it doesn't go away because we're allegedly free. And so people like you and you who have made conscious decisions to be fathers in you're fighting the stuff that has been put in us, but mm-hmm. some people don't have the tools for that fight. I had kids young, and I modeled, I wanted to be an actress, I wanted to be a comedian, but I never put it before them. I always said, if I honor them, God would honor me.
That's right.
One part I related to, you talk about your daughter on the special, mm-hmm. and you said that she told you, I hate you. Mm-hmm. And I remember those, like, when you grow up and you get to those years where you cannot stand your parents, and mm-hmm. you hate them, and you were like, good, I'm glad you said it first.
Yeah, because it's funny, because that kid, I talk to teenagers all the time, and they're like, oh, I can't stand my parents. I'm like, they can't stand you either. Like, we just don't say it. We've been socialized not to say that to our kids. And, you know, when people talk about having postpartum syndrome, they get taken down. But the reality is you got to normalize that. It's hard being a parent, and it's even harder being a good parent. Like, especially now when you battling the internet, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Like, it's so much materialism. It's all this stuff that's telling your kids there's something wrong with them. The most lauded people in the world are superficial and made in the lab, and you got your daughters saying, "Ooh, I want to be like that." And you're like, "No, they don't look like that for real. This, their souls are black and they're hurting on the inside." It's really hard. And yes. You know, I like people who are honest about not liking their kids. You know what I'm saying? The people, they didn't want me to say this, but I had a joke that said the people who pretend to like their kids are the ones that set them on fire and blame it on black dudes.
You're saying there's times that you don't like your kids, you know?
Right. Of course, okay, I adore them.
Like, yeah, she don't like our kids. I don't like it, but there's times when you don't.
That's a human emotion.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, and it's like in love. Like, I adore my kids and love them. I love them more than I love myself. Mm-hmm. But there are days where I'm like, get out of my face. Right. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And I didn't beat on my kids. Like, my mom used to beat us like we stole something, as they said. I never put my hands on my daughter.
Do you see the differences?
That's one of my favorite threats.
Oh, yeah.
One of my favorite threats. Well, you lucky you didn't grow up in the 90s.
Yeah, I always say that. Yeah, everybody, all my friends know. They always tease my kids because I always just say, I should have raised them.
I got to put my hands on my son.
Lucky you didn't grow up in the 80s. You got sons, though.
My son's bigger than me right now.
Oh, yeah.
So if I didn't, like...
His son will beat his ass, though, let's be clear.
If he had the heart to, like, you know, he's still scared of his father. Uh-huh. But if he realizes, I'm strong in this, even someplace, football,
he knows,
he's Diesel, he definitely could throw me around.
Well, I remember
I would jump him, though.
You would jump him.
Absolutely.
I punched my son in the chest one time.
You don't think I would call you and be like, yo,
I'm not coming to jump your son?
Yeah, that's ridiculous.
That's crazy.
That would be great content for the morning show.
We would definitely whip us both out. Wouldn't that
be
crazy?
Oh, my God. Do you know they love to hate you? You beat your son? You know, oh, my gosh. I can't imagine the memes. They'd be like, and he's a child abuser.
And he has Charlamagne with him.
I know.
And they both got beat up. But okay. Ida, how was it having your kids with you, too, on this journey?
Always great. They deserve every single ounce of any success that I get. And they have integrity, right? They're both quality. My daughter is an amazing writer. She's in a really good writer's room for a TV show, a major TV show. My son is a director, and he's a great director. Oh. And they want to make it on their own. Mm-hmm. And so they're like, we're not trying to ride your coattail. And I was like, you guys made the sacrifices in life so that I could do what I want to do, and this is yours, because I know that they're going to take it and they're going to multiply it.
I'm all about nepotism.
What?
I'm all about it.
Say, I'm here today because of nepotism, right? Like, because I have a relationship with y'all. Mm-hmm. And y'all brought me here before I'd had my own special, and it was, I'm here because of the relationships that I've made, and I'm not ashamed of that, and I don't think anybody should be. I am on a platform with three black American people, and Latin people won't put me on their platforms. I had to text you for Adesas and Mero.
Yeah.
All right, we got more with Ida Rodriguez. When we come back, don't move. It's The Breakfast Club. Morning, everybody. It's DJ Envy, Angela Yee, Charlamagne Tha God. We are The Breakfast Club. We're still kicking with Ida Rodriguez, comedian. Now, do you feel your own community doesn't support you?
Listen, I am where I am because black American people made way for me, created space for me, because I've always claimed my own blackness, and I've always been like, yeah, we do some messed up stuff. Tiffany Haddish put me on Netflix. Shaquille O'Neal put me on Showtime. Tamara Goins and Valerie Benning, two black women who are the producers, they put me on the Shaq Comedy All-Stars. Wanda Sykes put me on Last Comic Standing. And not that they put me on it, I earned it, because I worked my behind off to be good at what I do. But it wasn't HBO Max entre nos, the Latin people there that are, you know, Dominicans and Caribbeans, gave me a special and were the first one to headline me. But they wouldn't have known who I was had it not been for a Tiffany, had it not been for Wanda, mm-hmm. or Shaq. So I'm always going to stand in gratitude. Black American people have always made a way for Latin people in this country. And I love my people. That's not me hating on my people. That's just me stating the truth.
What about Latin women in comedy?
So Latin women in comedy, there's no one that's ever broken the ceiling. And to talk about people who claim their blackness, because Hollywood is so white in every aspect, even in the Latinidad spectrum. which is why you hear a lot of the pain from dark Latinx people from darker hues being very upset about being erased, that they don't even want to call themselves Latinos anymore. So it's just so complicated. So when it comes to women in comedy, there are some women, Sara Contreras, who's Puerto Rican from New York, Sheila Rivera, who was an astronaut, rocket scientist, that paved the way for someone like me who never had the opportunity to go the heights, you know, to get where they should have gotten, that were brilliant comedic women that made noise, that were Puerto Rican, the half flavor, and then nobody just didn't see it. That's why the special has to do well, because it's going to create a way for other people. It ain't no fun if the homies can't have none. It can't just be about me.
Talk about the significance of having a stand-up special.
Oh man, it's the culmination of all of the work. It is the epitome of the dream of a stand-up comedian. It's the Super Bowl for a stand-up comic, you know, to have their own special. And it is just all you. And for me, I was involved in every aspect. I wrote my own jokes. I did have help from some other comedians that guided me, that tagged jokes, that said, remove this here, do that. But I was told, you're never going to be on Shaq All-Star, because that was one of my goals. Like, I wanted to be, like, the first Latin woman to do it. They told me I was never going to get a comedy special. Like, this is other comedians, male comics. That I was never gonna get a TV show. You came in the game too late, and also there just isn't, you know, Latin women just don't have, they don't, there's, that doesn't exist. So I gotta create it.
How do white people react to you when you have to do stand up and the rooms are mostly white? Because some things that you say, I know people have walked out of your shows before.
Amazing.
And you're very unapologetic and make strong statements. And sometimes it just, I've seen it get a little bit awkward, even on the special. So what's that like for you?
That makes my soul full. It makes me so happy. I'll tell you why. I opened for Paul Mooney when I first started doing stand up. I was his baby, and he used to call me his little Marilyn McCoo bitch, and I didn't know what that was. I was like, what? He was like, you my little Jane Kennedy bitch. Like, that's what he used to call me, bitch. I never got offended. Mm-hmm. He used to always tell me, I better not ever see you look like, I'm not gonna say the word, we can't even say this word no more, but he was like, I better not ever see you look masculine on stage. And he used to always tell me, if they don't get up and walk out when you telling your truth, you're not doing your job. So Paul Mooney had just passed away, and I was in Austin doing Moon Tower. I was doing this theater show, and about like five or six white people got up and walked out. And I was like, that was Paul Mooney blessing me from the other side, saying, baby, you on your way. I remember doing a comedy show. And yes, I don't like this white girl who's a comedian and she knows who I am. I go on stage and she's doing.
She knows who she is.
She knows who she is, and she knows who I am, too. She does this joke, these comedic runs on the piano of introducing comedians. And her joke about me was that I had a knife hidden, and how many kids I had and how many fathers I had, right?
Wow.
And so then I went on stage and I said, there we go. Another talentless white woman who got to where she got because of who knows who she slept with. We all know white women can... I used to have this joke that was like, you know, women of color can't do what white women do. White women could sleep with 50 men and marry a senator. We can't do that because we have social consequences in the hood. And she was upset with me because I retaliated. Uh-huh. But that's constant. It's like we have had to listen to people talk about us. We didn't have the mic and they were talking about us. Then Def Comedy Jam comes along and now you hear the perspective of the people who you've always heard being framed in the that way. So it feels good to be able to say what I want to say, and I respect the white people who stay. More white people stay than leave. And if you look at my shows, they come see me over and over again, just like they used to go see Paul Mooney. And not that I'm comparing myself to the great, because that was my king and I adored him. It's just validation for me that some people want to hear the truth and some people like to be punished.
Plus they understand, like, you know, that's why I love saying cracker and on the radio and television, because I have this whole concept called decrackification and how you have to decrackify America and I compare it to denazification in Germany. And the good white people, I make them draw a line and just saying, either you a good white person or a racist, bigot, crack-ass cracker. Mm-hmm. Which one are you? And when you break down, like, just American history and the things that black and brown people have gone through in this country, good white people with logic understand.
Absolutely.
It's the crackers that's holding on to the bullshit.
Yeah, and some people are proud of being called crackers because of the root of what that word comes from.
Right.
You know, they really feel like, so when you think about it, listen, I don't do comedy for the people who don't like me. I do comedy for the people who rock with me. And I'm not for everybody, and neither is anybody else. I don't subscribe to what I don't like. I just think that if you don't like it, then don't pay attention to it.
When you do your stand-up, and the first time somebody walked out,
yeah,
what was your mentality? What did you do? Because I'm sure it was kind of startling at first, or did you expect it?
No, I didn't expect it. There's this feeling comedians will describe when you either going to bomb or something starts going awry, you start feeling hot on the inside, and it's like nerves. And I felt like, this is going to be bad.
So you said a joke. A couple got up and started walking out. So now you got to be nervous. Like, damn, is this going to start where everybody gets up and walk out?
Yes. And then, you know, it happened to me. It was in Texas. And this couple who was, everybody was having a good time. And this couple was sitting in the front, as a white couple. And the man, I was like, can y'all stop talking? And he said, can you start being funny? And then I was like,
that's where it started.
And then I was like, I went in. And then the audience turned on them, and everybody, they threw them out. I never worked that club again.
Well, that's not really walking out. They got thrown out.
No, but he was like, before they got thrown out, he got up and he was like, you know what? I don't need to be here. I paid money for funny, and I'm not getting funny. And then I don't remember what I was saying to him, but then the audience just started turning on him. And boom, when they started walking out, I was like, it felt like a Anchorman when they the perfume and everybody just started running amok. I was like, this is gonna be bad. When I was in Austin, I remember that moment full circle where people walked out and I didn't even dignify their exit by acknowledging it, and that hurt more because the audience was roaring and I was like, oh, focus on this.
Word.
Let them walk.
Alright, we got more with Aida Rodriguez. When we come back, don't move. It's the Breakfast Club. Good morning. Morning, everybody. It's DJ Envy, Angela Yee, Charlamagne Tha God. We are The Breakfast Club. We're still kicking it with Aida Rodriguez. Yee.
I was thinking that watching your special, real life observations can be so funny, right?
Mm-hmm.
Even then trying to like create a joke. Like you talk about, you know, everybody being anti-abortion.
Oh, and my family. Yeah, when I was talking about my family.
Yes.
Yeah, I said that joke here before when I came, and I finally was able to put it on stage for the special because, you know, there's this big divide between Latinx people, Latinos, Latine, and Black American people, as if, you know, we tell the lies. There's a lot of white supremacy within our community. And I have family members who felt like me having a baby from a Black dude was taking the race back. And so they were religious. They were like, my mom don't believe in nothing, and she got the best soul on the planet. And then the most religious people in my family are the worst. And right. So I told the truth. I was like, they were Christian and they were anti-abortion until I got pregnant from a Black dude, and then they became pro-abortion in the name of Jesus. They were like, he'll forgive you. And I was like, you know, this is interesting to me. I took that with me.
I know we talk about it. I think we talked about it before, and everybody always talks about it. What's the problem with Black men and Latino women? It just seems like Dominicans, Puerto Ricans don't want Black men in their house. Like, why?
I think that it is internalized self-hate. I think is racism. There is the belief that if you marry somebody white or you mate with somebody white, have children with something white, this is what we've been told, you're taking the race forward because everybody is aspiring to be white. Not everybody, but that's what the aspiration is. We got to get to the whiteness. Everybody's scared of Black men, and everybody loves Black men. Everywhere I go in the world, people got children with Black men because Black men are the men that are a commodity worldwide. Everybody, you don't ever hear people be like, ooh, I'm going to give me a dude from Thailand. Like, you know, you don't hear nobody saying that, right?
Although my dad is Chinese, which is very odd for people. They're like, your father's Chinese? Mm-hmm. How did that happen?
No, but you know, like, it's so ridiculous to not admit the elephant in the room. Black men, whether they're even Latino, like especially remember y'all be talking about it, the light skin, dark skin wars, that
brown people bag test
craziness. Mm-hmm. But secretly, those white women wanted the dark skinned Black man in their beds. You know, like look what they had to deal with.
Right. I do love how Latinos have politically been able to leverage that though. because you just don't know how they're going to vote. Like, you got the ones that think they're white in Florida, they might go conservative. Ones mm-hmm. in Texas might think they white, they go conservative. Cali, mm-hmm. New York, they go blue. So, you know, I like the way y'all been able to leverage it politically.
How do you feel about the reception from the special now that it's out? I know it was a long journey to get everything done. Mm-hmm. And you also managed to get this done during a pandemic.
Yeah, that was, it was hard. I feel good about the, I've had so many messages from people saying, I also met my father. You know, one thing that I admire, because there was a lot of pushback for me using the word Latino or Latinx, people saying we're not identifying as that anymore. We're identifying as Afro-Puerto Rican, which I think is beautiful, or Afro-Dominican. We don't even want to say Latino. I have a very different take on it, and this is my opinion, and if you disagree with it, eat a dick. One thing I respect about Black American people and what they're doing right now in America is claiming their Americanness. Because for some reason, there's been a long time of Black American people attribute this African-American label where they were not claiming their Americanness when they built this country. And just like slaves built this country, slaves built Puerto Rico, they built Panama, they built Cuba. And so I'm not going to claim being from my Latin Americanness because my ancestors built that bitch too.
Right.
And so mm-hmm. I know I came here to be funny or supposedly, but this is like,
this that's is what the side of you I love.
This is the comedy that lives in me. And that's what mm-hmm. the stuff I want to talk about is that I'm not going to not claim, you know, Puerto Rico, regardless of what it called, the colonizer called it, because my ancestors built that bitch too. And so I just think that it's important for us to be able to have perspective about the work that was done before us and stop disrespecting our ancestors' work because we see it as weak, as stuff that we would never be able to handle because we can't even handle when somebody tweets us something and tells us to die.
Oh, I hate when people say, I'm not my granddaddy. All right? We are not our ancestors or whatever it is. Yeah. It's like, yeah, you sure ain't.
No,
because you couldn't even endure what they endured.
Listen, and for the most part, I've gotten nothing but, you know, I've gotten so much love for the special. And so many people have showed up for me. And I know somebody was trying to get me canceled online.
They were?
Yeah, she was like, this is the chick that said that Puerto Rico is better than Black people because Puerto Ricans have their own country. And I'm like, I don't know if I've ever said anything like that. I don't know what I said back in the day, but I've never said anything like that because that just is not what I would say. I do acknowledge that Latin American people do have cultural they have a lot of cultural ties to Africa and their indigenous ties. A lot of stuff was maintained and preserved through folklore and other things that American Black people have not had.
Starting to embrace more now.
It was stolen and taken from them. Mm-hmm. And it wasn't because they're not savvy like Puerto Ricans are. It's just the reality of what was preserved. My grandmother would take care of me with leaves. You know, she wouldn't be like, go get an antibiotic. She was like, no, I can't hacer un té. Like, that was stuff that was, because she was illiterate. It was given to her by grandmother and great-grandmother. And that's something that I don't think is better. I'm just saying it is real. And that's why we have to respect Black American people and their journey here, because it's very different than ours.
What about the J Balvin controversy? Can you shed some light on that? Because I saw they were upset at him
for having two Black women on leashes. Yeah. Mm-hmm. That was, and then they also went in on the girl, the artist that's Dominican. And, you know, I think what J Balvin did was egregious, right? I think that was ridiculous. The dehumanizing of Black women's bodies, it needs to stop. It's been happening forever and it needs to stop. J Balvin needs an education. J Balvin needs to be able to, because J Balvin does go out and get other artists and uses his privilege to say, hey, I'm gonna bring this person aboard. I know I'm gonna get creamed for this, but I'm a big proponent of addressing the systems, and yes, we can take down individuals for them doing egregious stuff, but we focus so much on people and their acts, and because it's easier to take those down, because don't nobody want that smoke with Warner Media. They don't want that smoke with
AT&T.
That's
right.
It's easier to take somebody down who looks like you, sounds like you. Mm-hmm. I think what he did was awful, but I think we need to start focusing on the systems that perpetuate this stuff and make a lot of money on our pain and oppression. and stop trying to take other people down because we jealous because we want they spot.
In the Heights,
yeah,
had a similar issue.
Well, you know, In the Heights is, I understood what was going on. I just believe that there's a way to handle this situation that creates more for us. You know, and that for me is like, I'm trying to create equity. I'm trying to create an opportunity where a dark-skinned Black Latina can get an opportunity to make her own show and become her own showrunner. I'ma do that. I'ma Issa Rae this.
Damn,
you
right.
know? Because the reality of it is there's a lot of these motherfuckers who are on social media trying to burn shit down. They are just exercising their pain.
Mm-hmm.
It has nothing to do with activism. That's what was the special about. Tiffany made sure I got paid. You know what she said? You're going to get paid like a white man when I did They Ready. That was her thing. She took a pay cut. She was like, all y'all going to get paid like a white male comedian. And we did.
Thank you for joining us this morning. We appreciate
it. Gave a sermon this morning. But congratulations for real on everything.
Absolutely.
I saw how hard you worked on getting this to come out, and it is such an accomplishment. So I do want to say that we are so happy, so proud of you, so glad that you've been here now multiple times to be able to even share this space and be able to be on this journey with you.
I appreciate you guys showing up for me and always showing me love. And like I say, always about Black and brown people. I love us and I won't stop. So give it your best shot, boo.
Ida Rodriguez. It's
hey.
The Breakfast Club. Good morning.
It's time.
She's spilling the tea.
This is the Rumor Report with Angela Yee on the Breakfast Club.
The Houston Police Department and the FBI are conducting a criminal investigation into the trampling deaths that occurred at the Astroworld Music Festival. Now, according to reports, they're saying they want to know if this could have been prevented in any way, but it's also entirely possible that it was not preventable for whatever reason, and that's something they have to know as well. Mm. So far, at least 14 lawsuits have been filed against Travis Scott and festival organizers, Live Nation, and score more in Harris County District Court. The lawsuits accuse the organizers of prioritizing profit at the expense of concertgoers' health and safety, and accuse Travis Scott and Drake also of inciting mayhem.
In my mind, I would think, of course, it could be preventable, but I would love to know how it couldn't have been prevented. Is there a scenario where it's just too many people to contain?
Well, there was a lot of scenarios. I heard them break it down. One, they were trying to close some of the roads around, so a lot of the people that didn't have tickets couldn't come.
Because
a lot of people hopped the fence. There was a couple of things that they tried to get the city to do and tried to get the police department to do, allegedly, and some of that stuff couldn't get done. So, I mean, that might have...
Well, it's complicated, they said, because it's a lot of people involved and a lot of different entities as well. So they said there's a lot of videos that they're going to have to look at. But, you know, it's Harris County that owns the park, NRG Park, where the festival was held.
Mm-hmm.
But then there's also Harris County Sports and Convention Corporation. They oversee the event. The city of Houston issued the permits and had first responder authority. And then there were third parties like Live Nation, obviously Travis Scott, because he founded the festival, and private contractors who provided medical and security could possibly be liable if investigators conclude that their actions or that their negligence contributed to the injuries and deaths.
But, you know, with the promoters, you know, they have meetings upon meetings upon meetings. They have to have all types of security measures, ambulance and health measures. Then they do a pandemic type of measure. Then they do a weather measure. There's mad meetings going on to these events.
Now, authorities did discover that protocols for a crowd surge were not listed in the Astroworld Festival's event operations plan. And the Houston Fire Chief Samuel Pena said that he believes absolutely that Scott should have stopped the show as the chaos became increasingly evident. He said the one person who can really call for and get a tactical pause when something goes wrong is the performer.
Yeah, but how is the performer responsible?
The police department. The police can pull the show. They can stop the show.
But not only
that might really cause a frenzy.
What about
if
the people
police come on stage and stop the show?
No. They can talk to the sound man and stop the show, pull a plug and pull that. They can stop the show.
Then imagine that, like, the police are making us stop the show.
It might be off.
I just wonder if people...
They've done it before.
I wonder if these people saying that have ever stood on the stage and looked out at a crowd of 50,000 people.
Now the venue,
how can you see everything that's going
does
on?
Does have an insurance policy totaling $26 million, but that's nowhere near what the injured and families of the dead are going to be seeking. They're saying there's certainly possible. They certainly have coverage when it comes to Live Nation, when it comes to Travis Scott. We don't know what type of insurance coverage there is, but we do know the venue's liability insurance is $26 million.
I wonder how this changes things moving forward in regard the festivals, because I mean, events like this have happened at festivals before, and I'm sure that every time something like this happens, things change. So I wonder how this is going to change, you know, this era of festivals moving forward.
Now, we told you that day in Vegas that Travis Scott dropped out of that festival. He was headlining, but because of all of this, he just can't focus on that right now. So sure. Post Malone has been added to close out and headline instead. All right, now Teyana Taylor was doing her show in L.A., and I see a lot of performers doing this now. And so she actually stopped the show because she saw there was a fan who was slumped up against the barrier. Here's what that sounded like.
She okay? Get up here. I'm about to retire. You ain't gonna see me, baby. Come on, baby. You good? Say rose petal. Okay, baby, you good.
Yes, I have seen a few performers doing this, but they're not in front of 50,000 people. And it's much easier to do that when you're performing in front of a smaller crowd and not 50,000 people.
And they're doing it after Astroworld event. Mm-hmm. So it's more sensitive to people's...
Mm-hmm.
Well, again, our condolences go out to all the families, and my heart goes out to them, because imagine just, you know, going to a concert and then you don't 100%. Come home, or your family member doesn't come home, that 9-year-old who's in a coma right now.
It's tragic all across
tragic.
The board.
Mm-hmm. All right, now let's talk about People's 2021 Sexiest Man Alive. Stephen Colbert announced who was number one.
That was the last test, and you passed, Paul. You passed. You're sexy. Paul, you're the sexiest man alive.
I'm the sexiest man alive?
You're the sexiest man alive.
I'm the sexiest man alive.
So that's Paul Rudd, who is the sexiest man alive.
I want to recount.
Congratulations to him.
Dropping the clues bombs for Ant-Man. Congrats to Ant-Man. Okay, who wants Thor, Captain America, or the Black Panther? The sexiest Avenger alive is Ant-Man.
Mm-hmm. I want to recount.
Question, who votes on these things? Who's on the Sexiest Man Alive committee? Who's on the board?
I don't know. I don't know who this Paul Rudd guy is. But
you don't know
I
who Paul Rudd is?
I do.
Oh, but who's on the board for Sexiest Man Alive?
I don't know, but past people who, well, I told you last year was Michael B. Jordan. Idris Elba has gotten it. Ryan Reynolds. So
I just want to know how they come to these conclusions about who's the sexiest man alive. Is it just strictly physical?
I think it's more than that.
I don't know.
I think it's more than that.
If so, I think that they need to stop objectifying these men. And they just start looking at these men's intellect and the things that they do for the community, okay, and their philanthropy and things of that nature. Don't just objectify these men.
You sound like a hater.
Why do I sound like a hater? I don't want men to be objectified? What about
when
women say they don't want women to just be objectified? Isn't that what the Miss USA pageants and everybody is complaining about now?
I think it's more...
Exactly. But see, when a man does
I think they like his sense of humor as well.
I'm a
lot
hater?
Of that, too. You know?
Great. I just want more things than just the physical.
I'm a funny guy.
To be looked into when it comes to these sexiest man alive things. Stop objectifying these men for their physical appearance.
Yeah, I want to recount.
John Legend won previously. Dwayne Johnson, David Beckham, and all of that.
Rashawn Casey.
Nope. All right. And he did say that his wife, Paul Rudd, did say his wife was stupefied after he told her the news. And he feels there's a lot more people that deserve it before him. All right. And that is your rumor report.
Damn it. Should have been me.
Mm-hmm.
See, look at you looking at me. You agree?
No, I'm not.
Yes, you are.
I'm looking at you because you look stupefied. That's what I'm thinking. The same thing Paul Rudd's wife is thinking. This stupefied individual over here.
Oh, my God.
Okay.
All right. Well, who are you giving your donkey to?
That beard is glowing this morning, too. That's why you got that hoodie on, because that dye ain't settled.
Nah, ain't no dye, boy. Don't lie. Woo, I look fly today. I got my fresh haircut.
Yeah.
Look at that.
That fresh Beijing. Don't think we don't notice.
I don't know what Beijing is.
Go back to one of these videos earlier this week. You had some grays, a lot of grays. Now, all of a sudden, you black.
Shout to my brother Rick Ross.
Boy, you better stop.
Shout to Kevin Hart. Shout out to all my brothers out there.
The Beijing gang. Drop one of the clues bombs for the Beijing brigade. That's all you named just now.
Shout out to my brothers out there, man.
Okay? That's all you named.
Shout out to my brothers out there.
Now, Alika Unga Salifa. I think that's his name.
That's definitely not the name.
It's not, but he needs to come to the front of the congregation. We'd like to have a word with him this morning.
What's the name again?
I don't know. We'll figure it out.
All right. It's the Breakfast Club. Good morning.
The Breakfast Club. Your mornings will never be the same.
Angela here talking about my friends at the General Insurance. They offer flexible payment plans and the ability to choose your payment date. Plus, they let you choose how you pay, whether that's with cash, card, or check. Call 800-GENERAL or visit thegeneral.com to learn more today. Some restrictions apply.
I was born a donkey.
It's the donkey of the day.
Donkey, donkey, donkey. Bunch of
for the donkey of the day.
That's pretty funny.
Charlamagne the devil?
Possibly.
The Breakfast Club.
Yeah, donkey of the day for Thursday, November 10th goes to a bountiful Utah man named Alika Unga Sulifu. Is that how you pronounce his name? Let me hear it.
Alika Suliafu.
Okay, there you go. Alika Suliafu. And I don't mean bountiful as in he's a generous person. I mean, that's the name of the town. That's the name of the town in Utah. What the hell they do live? What the hell they doing living in Utah with a name like that? Say his name again.
Alika Suliafu.
Now, I don't know the race of this man, but I know Utah is 90.6% white. All right, I'm not the highest grade of weed in the dispensary, but Alika Suliafu doesn't sound Caucasian to me. Now, 1.5% of the population in Utah is black or African American. Others make up 5.04% of the population. I'm so confused. I thought black was African American. Do they mean like you can call them black or African American? And what exactly is others? Does it matter? Okay, what matters is Alika found himself in a situation. See, he is being held without bond on suspected charges of felony attempted murder and felony discharge of a firearm. What was the reason Alika let the hammer blam blam? Let's go to KSTU Fox 13 for the report, please.
A bountiful man is accused of shooting his father or shooting at his father over chicken wings. Charging documents indicate the victim brought back wings for his son, 31-year-old Alika Suliafu, last week. When Suliafu saw the wings were not the specific type he liked, police say he started to argue and then got a gun out of his father's bag. Police say he fired a shot, but his father ducked just in time, and then Suliafu continued to fire as they wrestled over the gun. One bullet flew into a neighboring apartment, but none of the shots hit anyone. Suliafu is now charged with attempted murder.
Believe you me when I tell you that a good piece of chicken can make anybody believe in the existence of God. I always say I don't understand how you could be vegan, because if you've ever bitten a piece of chicken, it's just worth it. All right, but I don't care if these wings are fried, grilled, smoked, baked. I don't care what kind of rub is on it. I don't care how it's glazed. I don't care if they are drums or flats. I don't give a damn if they're ranch flavored, sweet barbecue, Parmesan, garlic, teriyaki, honey barbecue, buffalo. I don't give a damn if the chicken wings are organic or GMO. I'm not throwing away my life for no damn chicken wings. And why would you shoot at your father because he brought home the wrong order? You trifling human. Probably wasn't even his fault. It was probably the restaurant's. I also want to know how bad can you ruin a chicken wing order? Myself, I prefer grilled chicken for dietary purposes. And I love honey barbecue, teriyaki, plain barbecue, and buffalo. But if I order one of those, and let's just say instead of teriyaki, they bring me honey barbecue, all right? Or if I ask for grilled and they come fried, I'm not going to waste the food. I'm not going to trip, especially trip enough to let the hammer fly. All right? You love chicken wings that much? Well, guess what? Ain't no chicken wings in jail. Not that I know of. All right? If some white sauce ends up on you in prison, I can guarantee it ain't blue cheese. But I have to feel empathy for this human, Alika, because something's wrong. All right? You're not shooting at someone over some chicken. There's clearly something deeper there. All right? That man is projecting a pain that a 10-piece lemon pepper can't fix. But you still have to give people the credit they deserve for being stupid, regardless of what cause said stupid. Do you understand that if we lived in a world where people could just shoot at you because you got their chicken order wrong, Kentucky Fried Chicken would absolutely be the most dangerous place in America. Bullets would be popping off like chicken grease in KFC if you could shoot at folks for getting their order wrong. And how are you from bountiful Utah doing things like this? Do you know what the word bountiful means? It means to give generously. That's what it feels like your father was doing, giving generously. All you gave your father in this situation was grief. I am sensitive to any mental or emotional issues this man Alika may have been having, but we all must be held to the consequences of our actions. And in this case, the price Alika had to pay is probably worth it. Please give Alika, what's his name?
Alika Suliafu.
Please give Alika Suliafu the biggest hee-haw. I love me some chicken, but not this much. No.
All right.
No.
What?
No.
What?
No.
What?
Just no.
All right.
Just no.
Ask E is next.
We're not playing the game of guess what race it is.
Just a question. Or what?
Okay.
I was confused. So if it's not blue cheese, what's the other white sauce?
Ranch.
Oh, ranch. All right. ASCII is next. 800-585-1051.
Thought that I, me, Lenard McKelvey, Charlemagne the God, Uncle Charlotte, Brother Lenard, you thought I was going to fall for that.
ASCII is next.
Come on now.
585-1051.
You know me better than that.
I know you better than that. That's why I was waiting. 800-585-1051. If you need relationship advice or any type of advice, call ye right now. It's The Breakfast Club. Good morning.
The Breakfast Club.
Come on.
Need relationship advice? Need personal advice? Just need real advice. Call up now for Ask Ye.
Keep the bread.
Morning, everybody. It's DJ Envy, Angela Yee, Charlamagne Tha God. We are The Breakfast Club. It's time for Ask Ye. Hello, who's this?
Yeah, man. It's D. Caller from Hot Atlanta. And shout out to Ursa, because this is part two of my confession.
The first time you called Ask Ye because you had cheated on your wife.
Right, with a shout out for Instagram.
Okay, with somebody from Instagram. And so what happened after that? We spoke on Ask Ye.
And you gave me some advice on how to take my time and get her the time and space that she needed.
Mm-hmm.
Then she finally came around and said, okay, we've been together for a minute. We could probably work through this. Just don't do that no more.
Right, okay. So,
I deleted my Instagram account.
Okay, that's a good first step.
And my Facebook, too.
All right, so you mean business. You're not going to cheat on your wife anymore.
Right.
So now what?
The girl called me and said she's pregnant.
Okay, so the girl that you cheated on your wife with, who you met on Instagram, is now pregnant.
Right.
Are you positive that she's pregnant, or do you think she's saying that because you deleted everything?
She could be pulling my leg. I say, go get a pregnancy test, and she didn't stall on going to get it. And I say, let me see it for myself. She ain't no saying no pictures, so it could be 50-50.
All right, I'm going to tell you what my advice is in this situation. Is it's very, I think, stressful when you know that this woman could at any point try to contact your wife, because if she's doing this, either she is pregnant or she isn't, but either way, this is going to be something that potentially could come up, right? She wants you to think right. That whether or not she's pregnant, and she's probably going to contact your wife. That's what it feels like. And when you have something like that weighing on you, not knowing when it's going to happen, your wife would much rather hear this from you than from some woman.
Okay.
So, sir, you done made your bed that you have to lie in, but you cannot lie to your wife. And you have to let her know what's going on. Because one of two things could happen. Well, one of three things. Either she's going to ride or die with you, and it'll be you and her, and... You know, if this woman is pregnant and does have a child, you do have a responsibility that you are obligated to take care of because of whatever transpired between the two of you. Or if she's not pregnant for real, or if it's not your kid and she is pregnant, then that's somebody that you can cut off permanently. But either way, there's a chance that your wife is going to find out.
Yes, I need to go ahead and tell her.
And that's a hard conversation to have, but you have to let her know, look, moving forward, I am always going to be honest with you and let you know everything that's going on in my life. And so here's the scenario.
Man, I'm just so nervous to tell them because we gained so much, but I feel like I'm about to lose it all.
And you are.
And, you know, you could. But listen, we've seen people stay together even after the side piece had a baby. We've seen it happen. So I'm not saying it can't happen. You know, it like you said, it's 50-50. We don't know. But I do know this. If she hears about it from that other woman, or if you have to tell her after the baby's here, that ain't going to be good either.
Dang. Okay, I'm going to go ahead and let her know today, dude.
Right.
She's probably going to be listening to her on the station.
All right.
So what if she hears it on The Breakfast Club before you get to tell her?
Damn.
Have you thought about that?
That wasn't smart.
Huh?
That gonna be
ill
too. I don't think she listens to the radio on her job, but if she do, then I'm pretty up.
Breakfast Club got millions and millions of listeners, bro. Somebody knows your voice. What's your name again?
Don't tell him.
My name is D.
What is it?
D.
And where you calling from, D?
Hotlanta.
Atlanta, Georgia.
Social security number and license plate, please.
I ain't doing all that.
You done did too much.
You might as well.
You gotta draw the line somewhere. All right. All right, take care in Hotlanta.
Okay.
All right, man. Goodness gracious.
Look at the bright side. He's in Atlanta. He can get a boyfriend after this.
Yo, shut up, man. You're on a roll this morning. I ask ye, 800-585-1051, if you need relationship advice or any type of advice. It's The Breakfast Club. Good morning.
Here's some real advice with Angela Yee. It's Ask Ye.
Morning, everybody. It's DJ Envy, Angela Yee, Charlamagne Tha God. We are The Breakfast Club. We're in the middle of Ask Ye. Hello, who's this?
This is Neil.
Hey,
good morning. What's your question for you?
I'm basically have been in a relationship for the past 5 years, going on 6 years. Mm-hmm. And she has been constantly cheating on me. She's only admitted one of them, only because the girl basically sent me all the text messages between them.
Okay.
That she was in a relationship with her for almost a year, and I didn't even know it.
So you've been in a relationship, but your girlfriend hasn't?
Basically.
Okay, so what's the question here?
I honestly don't know what to do because we do have a daughter together. And I've been trying to hang in because of my daughter and because I know she can be a good person. She does a lot. And like recently we found out that my daughter's epileptic and I lost my job. And her income right now is the only income that's coming in the house.
Listen, you said she's a good person, right?
Yes.
But she's not a good girlfriend.
No. I can say that.
And do you believe that she'll still take care of your child? Your child together?
I don't know because it's like 1 minute she wants to be there, 1 minute she doesn't want to be there. But then she tells me, like, she's gotten gifts from this girl that's like $500-$600. And she's basically told me that that's the only reason why she was talking to her is because she was buying her things.
Okay, now what kind of morals does this woman have if she's going to cheat on you for somebody that's buying her gifts? Is that somebody you even want to be with?
Honestly, I don't. I just don't know how to let go. I don't know how to move on.
Right. First of all, you have to think about your daughter. Do you want your daughter to see this relationship and think this is what it's like? Because I'm sure some of those things spill over into the household.
Yes, it does.
You're raising a young girl, right? Is this
right.
an example of a positive relationship that you want her to see?
No.
Are you happy?
Honestly, no, I'm not.
Okay.
Like, I try to make myself happy so that she's around, but honestly, no.
Okay, well, I want you to be able to find happiness, and you're not going to find happiness by trying to make yourself happy and letting somebody do whatever it is that they want to do, and you still stay there and be with them. She's cheated on you multiple times. She had a whole relationship. Her justification was that she was getting presents. She won't even admit things to you except for the fact that you saw all the text messages, so it was undeniable. She has a problem.
Yeah.
You don't have a problem. She has a problem.
Yeah, and she also said, too, when I found out about this girl that she was cheating on, she also said that it's because I have an attitude problem.
Of course you do. I have an attitude problem for you right now. Why wouldn't you?
Yeah. And that's one thing I told her, like, you don't realize, like, sometimes I have deja vu. Like, she would say things to this girl that she says to me. Like, because she worked a lot, so she would wake up in the morning and text her, "Good morning, baby." And then 2 seconds later would text me the same thing.
I just feel like, do you want to be in a relationship with somebody where you have to go through their text messages to find out what they're really doing? Then you find those things out and you stay, and then they keep doing those things, and then they try to blame you.
Yeah.
She has to get some serious help for herself. But for you, I don't want to see you in that situation. You're a strong woman. You have a daughter who looks up to you. You will find another job or a way to support yourself. But what I don't want to see is you being miserable.
Okay. Thank you.
You're welcome.
All right.
Ask Yee, 800-585-1051. If you need relationship advice or any type of advice, you can call Yee. Now we got rumors on the way.
Yes, and let's congratulate Summer Walker. We'll tell you what she has earned. And we'll also tell you what she has to say about her baby daddy, London on the Track, claiming that he contributed to her album.
Listen up.
It's just in.
All the gossip. The Rumor Report.
Gossip.
With Angela Yee.
It's The Rumor Report.
The Breakfast Club.
Will Smith was on Good Morning America because, as you know, his memoir, Will, is out right now. And one of the things that he said is that they don't have a conventional relationship, but they're working. Listen to this.
Why are everybody so fascinated with what's going on with you and Jada?
We are pursuing the kind of love that everybody dreams about. And we just know that the road don't look like everybody think it's supposed to look. But, don't try this at home, children.
Yeah, you don't give relationship advice necessarily.
I don't feel like I'm necessarily equipped yet to give relationship advice.
Dropping the clues bombs for the Willy Llama. Okay, I cannot wait to read Will's book. That's my Saturday and Sunday me time, reading Will.
Mm-hmm. All right, Will Smith also gave his co-stars bonuses for when King Richard, right, from that movie, and that's going to be coming out, I think, next Friday. So what he did was it's a simultaneous HBO Max and theatrical release. So that means people aren't going to get paid what they would get paid if it was just in the theaters. And so basically he personally gave everybody some money.
Hey, Will Smith gives great thoughtful gifts. He sent me a box yesterday mm-hmm. for his Will book. That was absolutely positively one of the greatest presentations I've ever seen in my life, and by far the greatest presentation for a book ever. It's incredible.
All right, now Summer Walker has earned the biggest 24-hour debut of a female artist of all time on Apple Music with her album Still Over It. So congratulations to her.
Of all time?
Yes, in the initial 24-hour period. Wow. Well, that's on Apple Music. So you got to think, it's not like Apple Music was around way back in the day.
But I would think Taylor Swift or Taylor, that wasn't around for Taylor.
Well, I mean, for 24 hours, it quickly shot to number one. It's her debut album, too, though. I said debut album.
Okay. Well, congrats to Summer Walker.
Absolutely. Dropping the clues, mom, for Summer Walker.
Well, 24-hour debut by a female artist. Yeah, so that's a big deal. It's mm-hmm. on the, it was number one on the all-genre chart, and all of its, still over its 20 tracks currently occupy the top 22 positions on the chart. Yikes. Good for her, though. I love that album. So they said her Spotify streams are also highlighted by a career best debut of No Love that racked up to 760,000 streams in only 10 hours. So congratulations. Wow. Yes. All right. Now, Summer Walker also had some things to say about London on the Track because, you know, his name is all over that album. And somebody had posted that, you know, he got paid off of his own diss album and he posted Fair Exchange. And she wanted people to know that that is absolutely not true. She said he didn't write Ish and he didn't produce Ish either. He just handpicked the people he wanted to do all the work and attached his name to it while he was out. I don't know if I could say this, but let's just say having sex with other women while I was pregnant. And she said that he might have contributed to Still Over It. It was a sprinkle, a wind chime effect on a song that was already done. The last album, he actually did the work and it was a great project. He's super talented. But for this album, no, sir. But I guess the City Boys is up, taking credit for Ish You Ain't Do and not actually having to take care of the kids you made. Woo. Mm. All right. Well, you know, all of that passion went into making a great album. So congratulations to Summer Walker on this album breaking records. All right. Now, Aaron Rodgers has been fined by the Green Bay Packers and also receiver Allen Lazard after a review found the team and its two players did not follow protocol for COVID. The Packers were fined $300,000 and they were individually fined $14,650 each. That doesn't seem like a lot
at all. Not even a little bit. Mm-mm. And he don't seem like he's getting tortured in the media the way that, you know, he would be.
Now, both of them attended a Halloween party despite being unvaccinated. So that is a violation of protocol as well. If you guys recall, Aaron Rodgers was very dodgy about whether or not he was vaccinated.
Are you vaccinated and what's your stance on vaccinations?
Yeah, I've been immunized. You know, there's guys on the team that haven't been vaccinated. I think it's a personal decision. I'm not going to judge those guys. It's an interesting issue.
So he tried to play with words a little, and he did afterward. This was him taking responsibility.
You know, I made some comments that people might have felt were misleading. You know, to anybody who felt misled by those comments, I take full responsibility for those comments.
Mm-hmm. Misleading.
You remember after Kyrie Irving got on Instagram Live and was explaining himself, he got crucified again mm-hmm. in the media. And then Aaron Rodgers goes and does this interview and says things like, you know, he's getting his medical advice from, you know,
Joe Rogan.
Yeah, media sources. Like, it's like, come on, man. It's like, where's the crucifixion?
It's crazy.
All right.
And this low fine, is he going to miss any games?
Apparently not. He just paid $14,000, which is nothing to him. All right, well, that is your rumor report.
All right, shout out to Revolt. Everybody else, the People's Choice mixes up next. Let's go.
The Breakfast Club. Your mornings will never be the same.
Warner Brothers Pictures presents King Richard, based on a true story that will inspire the world. Watch Will Smith's portrayal of Richard Williams, father of two of the greatest sports legends, Venus, Serena, and A Plan for Greatness, in theaters and on HBO Max. King Richard, November 19th, rated PG-13. EJ, Envy, Angela Yee, Charlamagne Tha God, we are The Breakfast Club. Now, shout out to Aida Ida Rodriguez for joining us this morning.
Big Ida!
Mm-hmm.
Yes, her special Fighting Words is on HBO Max right now, man. Ida's really, really, really dope. So salute to Ida Rodriguez.
Absolutely. And shout out to all the Latino artists that are giving me their call for the car show.
They came out to support their Dominican brother. That's what's up, man. If they didn't show up for you in Florida, I'd have been upset.
Prince Royce, Farruko, Nicky Jam, Anuel, thank you. And then shout out to my brother Nori, 50, Dwayne Wade, Khaled, Yo Gotti, Flo Rida, Trina, and a host of others that's going to be giving me their cars. I really appreciate it. Can't wait to see you guys in Miami on 12.
I can't wait to see that Latino picture with you and all the Dominican people that, and Spanish, so Latino people that gave you their cars.
So what should I wear?
Huh?
What should I wear?
White jeans. the Puerto Rican flag. No, you Dominican. The Dominican flag.
I hate you, man. I hate you. All right, man. When we come back, we got the positive note. Don't move. It's the Breakfast Club. Good morning. Morning, everybody. It's DJ Envy, Angela Yee, Charlamagne Tha God. We are the Breakfast Club. Now, Charlamagne, you got a positive note?
I do, man. Listen, every single thing you do matters. You have been created as a one of a kind. You have been created in order to make a difference. You have within you the power to change the world. Don't forget that.
Breakfast Club, bitches!
Y'all finished or y'all done?